And I'm standing on of you, Jesus. Yes, I'm standing on of you. And I let
from us, didn't it? And one of the things that it denied us of at the time was the chance to celebrate the life of John Magnenat. So why are we here 7 months after John left us? Why are we here? Well, I'll give you a few good reasons. We're here because his family needs this. His family needs to honor him, his family needs to say goodbye, and his family needs to see the people who loved him. We're here because this church needs this. Some lives mean so much to so many people that they can't go uncelebrated. John was one of those lives, and this church and his other friends who are here need this moment corporately to share in grief and to share in remembrance. And I'd like to give you one more reason we're here. We're here for the next generation. I know that there are some rather young people here who aren't related to John who are saying, gosh, I really didn't know John that well. He was an older man at church. I didn't talk to him too much. Why am I here? And kids, I'm going to tell you why you're here. You're here because this man showed us how to live. And you are lucky enough to get a piece of that today, a summary of that today. We want to show you how a life is lived properly. John Magnenat did that. And that is why we are. Let's pray together. Oh, great God, we thank you for a chance to gather. We thank you that you're Lord of all. And even when pandemic struck, we knew that you would be Lord of all. And you are. And you've given us a chance to be here. We thank you for John. We thank you for the way your Holy Spirit filled him and the way that he lived. I pray, God, that on this day we will all sit up and take notice and remember and look and see what it is to be a person of God. Thank you for giving us such a final example. In Jesus' name we pray.
Good afternoon, friends of John. We really appreciate you being here to honor him and this memorial. I've asked my kids, Heidi and my kids, to come up here and help us out with this. So I'm going to ask Rachel if you would come up here and read a quick one-page story told by my Uncle David, T.O.W. Okay? This is our youngest daughter, Rachel Stanley.
Memories of John by his brother-in-law, Colonel David H. Gruer. I was 14 years old when my dad, Major Hilmar Gruer, and my stepmother were transferred from Buenos Aires to Santiago, Chile, following their wedding. Just a couple of days after arriving, I learned that the Corps band was rehearsing that night. I went to the practice and was given a euphonium to play. Shortly after the rehearsal began, I put my hand up and mentioned I didn't understand why my music consisted of only A's on the second space. It happened that the band librarian had handed me the tune book for the drum. Things quickly improved when I had the euphonium music. John, who was single at the time, lived close to the Corps with his parents, Major and Mrs. L.E. Magnenat. Following rehearsals, several bandsmen would go to the Magnenat quarters, which happened to be just next door to where I lived with my parents. We would stay a while, listening to recordings on vinyl records, played on a gramophone. Entering the Magnenat home, I saw the photograph of a young lady in a candidate's uniform. Something extraordinary happened to me. I found myself struck by what to me was the most beautiful young lady I had ever seen. It was John's sister Renee, who had gone to train at the International Training College in London. When she returned to her home territory to work as a private secretary at the THQ, she came straight from the airport to a welcome meeting at the Corps. The band was playing a prelude while waiting for Renee to arrive. When she got to the Corps, she walked right up to her place in the cornet section. She smiled and winked, and I was sure that wink was for me. That night, I prayed that God would open the way for Renee to become my wife. 7.5 years later, we were married in Havana, Cuba. It was there that our first daughter, Florence, was born. The Castro communist government was making it constantly more difficult for churches to function. Seeing that we were the only overseas officers with a child left in Cuba, it was decided that it would be best for us to have a change of appointment. We headed to Winnipeg, Canada, where Renee's parents and John's family were. John and Rafi lived a couple of houses from the St. James Corps, where John was bandmaster. We moved into their home until we left for our new appointment in Panama. We were to remain in Winnipeg for 6 months before the visas and traveling arrangements were finalized. I had a wonderful time playing trombone in the band and accompanying on the piano. Tio Juan and Tia Rafi enjoyed getting to know Florence. Florence and Gunnar spent most of their days playing on the floor. It was a special treat to be all together at John and Rafi's for Christmas that year. At the end of our first 6-year term of service in South America East, we spent a few weeks in Toronto with my sister, then headed to Seattle to stay with the Magnenats. This would be the first of several furloughs spent staying with them in Seattle. What glorious times we had visiting Abuelita and Abuelito Magnenat in their home, participating in the ministry of Seattle Temple, where John was the bandmaster. I enjoyed my time there, playing the trombone and singing with the songsters. The Gruer and Magnenat cousins all developed a great love and care for one another during our stays. In 2004, John's wife Rafi was stricken with tuberculosis in the brain. For the next 12 years, John faithfully visited Rafi in the nursing home daily. What an example of a loving and faithful husband and a Christian gentleman John was. A highlight of our homeland furloughs was our time with our family in Seattle. I could no longer think of John as my brother-in-law. John was, for me, the brother I never had. I conclude with the best birthday gift I could have received on my 80th birthday. My family was in our home in Toronto for the birthday party. Suddenly the door opened and in comes Gunnar. I started weeping as I hugged my nephew, but the door opened once more and there was John, who had come with Gunnar to celebrate my big day. Well, I lost it. I hugged and kissed John and cried like a baby. What a birthday. Someday we will meet again, my dear brother John.
can concur that my tio David was known as the crying colonel. He was very, very emotional and beloved, still is, I'm sorry, beloved officer and uncle to us. And I just want to give you some information on one of John's grandchildren. So Rachel is our youngest daughter. Heidi's her mother, my wife. And she's a school teacher. And she's sitting here with her first child, Jack, who's a little redhead, just like Grandpa used to be. And Jeff Stanley. And I don't know how it happens. Jack's got so much Spanish blood in him, but he turned out to be a redhead. But I can tell you his first words were, ay, 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 ay. So, I think Philip, I think it's appropriate if we call John's doppelganger up next. This is our son, Philip Magnenat. And Philip just received his master's degree. So he's going to be a school counselor. Go ahead, son.
When I think about my grandpa, a few words come to my mind that I will always remember him by. The first was his resilience. I don't know if I will ever truly be able to appreciate my grandfather's story, the grit and resilience he displayed time and time again throughout his life. Knowing where he came from, humble beginnings as the son of missionary parents living in South America, the obstacles he had to face and overcome in his life, including immigrating and moving countries multiple times to brand new communities, to where he ended up, it is all truly inspiring. I also think of his boldness. He was bold and courageous in everything that he did. In his relationships, even when loving others caused him pain and suffering, he was bold in the incredible ways he played his music and mentored others as young musicians, and in the way that he shared his faith with others, oftentimes with complete strangers. And finally, I think of his compassion. He was always stirred by his faith to serve those around him who weren't as fortunate as he was. He made weekly trips to the food bank to volunteer and serve those facing food insecurities. He did his best to speak to others in their native tongues, oftentimes learning their languages, a kind gesture that makes one feel known and loved. He also spent many cold nights raising money for the Salvation Army as a bell ringer for those in need. He was a man filled with compassion. But all these things were only sustained because of his enduring faith in Jesus. He was resilient and persistent because he knew that God was faithful and would never leave him, even in the most difficult of circumstances. He was bold because Christ's love for us was bold, radical even, and it compelled him to do likewise. And he was compassionate because of the example that Jesus set for us in Mark 2:17, when he said, "It is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. For I have not come to call the righteous, but the sinners." Christ was always found with the poor, the sick, and the outcasts. And my grandpa knew that as a follower of Christ, he was called to do the same, showing them compassion and Christ's love through acts of service. And now that his time on earth has ended, he gets to experience the fullness of Christ's love for eternity, which was something that he was always ready for, whether we wanted him to be or not. He leaves behind a family that adored him and will miss him dearly, as well as a church community that loved him, that knew of his quiet commitment and steadfastness that was unmatched. My grandpa John was an unassuming man. He was humble, but when we stop to think about it, his impact upon our lives and those around us was far greater than we will ever know. And it was all because of his faith. And he earned his reward in heaven, living 94 incredible years as a testimony to his Maker. May we honor him and do likewise.
Likewise, for those of you that knew John a long time, this is his oldest grandson, Philip, and he's a newlywed. Oh, I'm sorry. Justin's the oldest. Oldest guy. I'm sorry. I'm getting old. Philip's a newlywed, recently married to Danielle, his lovely bride that's right behind Amy Green right here. So that's a little something about Philip. Thank you, son. Becca, how about if you come up next? Becca is our oldest daughter. She's going to share something from my cousin Pauline, who is the core officer at York Minster Temple in Toronto, Canada. Major Pauline Brewer Coffee. Need to give the titles.
Thanks. And I wanted to start just by thanking the band. You guys did a beautiful job, and I think Grandpa would be very happy with the musical worship we had this morning. So this is from Colleen and her family. To our dear cousins, Gunnar, Fred, and Brita and family, as you prepare to celebrate your dad's life, we wanted to send our love and share again a little bit of how much he meant to us. We admire how Tia Juan and Mom, brother and sister, maintain such a close bond, even though raising their families so far away from each other without the advantages of Zoom, FaceTime, and emails. Simply using handwritten letters or prayers for each other. As children, Mom would lead us in prayer each night before going to sleep. Bless Abuelito, Abuelita, Tia Juan, Tia Rafi, Primo Gunnar, Primo Philip, Primo Fred, Prima Brita. The family bond was imprinted in our hearts and minds. We are deeply grateful for Tia Juan becoming like a true big brother to Dad. Dad can trace their friendship back to his early teens, even before Mom and Dad became interested in each other. Tall, strong, patient, gentle giant Tia Juan would pick us up at the airport when on homeland furlough. With Tia Rafi would rearrange the house, thank you for giving up your rooms, making us feel at home even when staying for 2 months. At home, six transformed into a home for 11. How did they do it? Those days shaped us, gave us a sense of belonging as we prepared to go to a new country for the next missionary term. He always made us feel that we were family no matter how long or far away we had been from each other. Tio Juan's love was unconditional. The effort he made to present for our significant days. We especially remember his trip to Toronto to spend a week with Mom while she was still able to enjoy a visit before she was promoted to glory. The renewed energy his presence brought to his little sister. His faithfulness to the Lord. What an example of what it means to be a part of the body of Christ. We saw and heard of him taking on roles and duties as needs arose, regardless of whether it meant leadership or behind the scenes, putting the well-being of others first, loving God and loving others. And we heard of the joy this brought to his life. His intercession for us, for Pauline, with each new appointment, knowing that Tia Juan was interested in the details and faithfully interceded for us. As you celebrate a life well lived, we join you thanking God for Tia Juan and allowing us to see glimpses of Jesus in him. We love you, Primos, Lawrence, Pauline, and Hilmar. And if I can just say a few words, we got a chance to share a little bit yesterday at the graveside service, but just to kind of reiterate, I think some of the things that I remember the most about Grandpa is just his courage to be with Grandma, to immigrate to a new country, as Phil said multiple times, and just seeking out those new opportunities, not just for himself, but for future generations, the way that they paved a path for us. As someone else has mentioned, his faithfulness to Grandma, all those years and the days that he visited her in the nursing home, he never missed a day. He was always there whenever we came to visit. And two of the things that I'm most grateful for is how he instilled in me this desire to be a lifelong learner. He was a very avid reader, and even into his late 80s and 90s, he was teaching himself French. And most importantly, I'm just very grateful for how he raised my dad, because he He's the best dad I could have asked for.
Okay, I get to brag a little bit. Becca has her degree from SPU. She is the marketing manager for the Seattle Kraken. So when you see all those cool slogans for the NHL team, she's part of that. Who'd you have dinner with the other day? Was it Todd Lewicki? He's kind of a big deal here. Anyways, I'm kind of proud. Thank you. Also, one last thing I need to say about my kids. Thank you for agreeing to read things at the last minute. In fact, once we got here, we were still busy editing some things. So thank you for that. And thank you for being flexible. That is definitely a trait of my dad. Even though my dad was known in the Army world for his band leadership across several continents, several countries, over many decades, 50 years actually, he was always flexible and he wanted to share whatever ability he had. So it really wasn't about his ability, more was about his availability and making his availability to God available. So an example of that is I was really shocked when in Dad's retirement years, he was participating in Home League. Now, if you're not in the Salvation Army, you need to know Home League is for women. So here's my dad leading a Bible study for women. I'm not sure how he could relate, but somehow he did. And in his obituary, or actually I think there's a video of him where he talks about how he decided to improve his Bible knowledge so he could impart some wisdom to some of the ladies in the Bible study. I think that's where you met, right, Amy? That's where you met in the Home League. Okay. All right. Great. So I'm going off scripture. I'm sorry. So if you see my wife going like this, that means I'm going too long. Actually, it's usually my kids that do that. So, all right, I'll try to keep it short. But before I get to what I prepared, I saw Dave Gregg. Where are you? Right there. Okay. I was thinking of you when I saw you, and I know you traveled a ways to be here today. Thank you for that. But, you know, do you remember that tone poem by Leslie Condon, The Call of the Righteous? It's based on The Roll is Called Up Yonder. And when I locked eyes with you for a second, I thought, man, I wonder if Dave remembers that section in The Call of the Righteous where about a minute and a half in, if my memory serves me correct, it's been a few decades, but the drum starts up with, and next, you hear cornets. Not the lead cornets, but the backbench cornets providing some counterpoint. And I'm not going to sing because, you know, I wouldn't be right. But they're providing this counterpoint, kind of pushing The Roll is Called Up Yonder, preparing the way. And then the melody comes in beautifully. And I was just thinking about that. I wonder if that's the tune that was being played and sung when Dad left this earth. I'll be there when the roll is called up yonder. Okay, let me just share a few thoughts that I did write down. Juan Elias Magnenat went by many names, many titles, Bandmaster to Salvationists, John to his employers and friends, Juanito to his childhood chums and my mom, Tio Juan to his nieces and nephews in Canada, and Dad to his children. And I need to also remind myself, I'm reading this on behalf of my brother and sister who are not here because of COVID concerns. So Fred Magnenat in Kailua, Hawaii, and Brita Burks, who is in Las Vegas, Nevada. Dad believed in the proverb, more is caught than taught. He included the Magnenat kids in all aspects of his service to others. He had the good sense to expose us to the consequences of alcohol and drug usage by having me, Philip, and Fred go to the Harbor Light downtown Seattle on Skid Row. And in that Salvation Army facility, we provided musical accompaniment to the church services there. This is before Brita was old enough to play, so we would have been probably in elementary school. At Thanksgiving, he took us there to help serve meals with our grandparents, Brigadier Eli and Ruth Magnenat, who were retired officers, retired missionaries, but they still volunteered by bookkeeping and assisting the men there. One time I remember being rewarded with a piece of mincemeat pie. They said it was, quote, good for me. Yuck. All was not lost because Mom had pumpkin pie with lots of whipping cream on top waiting for me when I got home. That's for you, Fred. Dad and Mom spent many summers teaching at the music camp held at Camp Arnold at Timberlake in Eatonville, Washington, out by Mount Rainier, and at Camp Lake Boren in Renton. Before that, Dad also taught at music camps in Canada. As a child, I loved spending our family vacation at camp with my parents. They volunteered as musical leaders, and we were provided a chance to experience the innocence of being in the great outdoors. We made new friends, meeting some outstanding musicians along the way, such as Lieutenant Colonel Ruby Adams. While Ruby Adams was instructing us, my dad was tutoring students, including some like her son Greg Adams, who later in his career became a featured horn player in the Tower of Power and went on to recording prowess. Of course, not everybody under Dad's tutelage ascended to platinum level recording heights, but they were all left with an indelible imprint by Dad's kindness and willingness to share what he had. As a child, all the way through to young adulthood, I remember Mom and Dad's home being a place where young musicians would come to receive music lessons. Dad's workshop in the basement would be transformed into a cacophony of long tones, precise articulations, and endless arpeggios. All this hard work by his students resulted in improved confidence in their music making. I think confidence is something more of our young people need, and that's what the impression that was left with me. In addition to leading music at Seattle Temple, Dad also assisted various groups, such as the Ukrainian Church in Ballard, that tried to form their own brass band. He led the group weekly, and this was in the 70s, I remember that much, and he provided lessons to the band members. This included a gentleman who later became a Salvationist named Steve Marcination. He's in some of the band pictures. Steve's family became friends of our family. It was always a package deal with Dad and Mom. If Mom befriended you and you had young kids, you got Dad helping you with music lessons. If Dad befriended you and you had young kids, you got some good parenting advice and loving child care from Mom as part of the deal. The memories I have of Dad were most top of mind. Most of these memories had nothing to do with banding or music, though. Every night at dinner, we would pray in Spanish, thanking the Lord for the day and the food we were about to eat. It started like this: Gracias, Señor, por este día y estos alimentos. That simple act has stuck with me and my wife, and we have tried to pass this on to our kids to give thanks. My dad took seriously the instructions found in the Bible, and he modeled James 1:27 for us, where it says, "Religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this, to look after orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world." This was demonstrated by having people stay at our house while they got on their feet and going to widows' houses to perform free yard work. What teenage boy wouldn't want to spend a Saturday doing free yard work? While at the time I didn't like the duty, I now see this is the way our society should work. We help each other out in our time of need, and God will bless us with his mercy and kindness. Dad was a good son. He was involved in Brigadier Eli and Ruth Magnenat's lives. They followed him from South America to Winnipeg, Manitoba, and then to Seattle, Washington. Dad instilled into his family the importance of staying connected. We had dinner or lunch every Saturday with Grandpa and Grandma so they could be reassured that the rumors of their grandchildren's demise were greatly exaggerated. My brothers and I did get into a bit of trouble, just for the record. Dad alternated sending Philip and me regularly on Saturday mornings as elementary school-aged boys on the 6th and Stoneway bus all the way from North Seattle, where we lived, down to 43rd and Stone, where our grandparents lived. We would do chores for Grandpa Ali and Grandma Ruth. Whether it was washing perfectly clean walls or clearing blackberry bushes behind their little house, we were always rewarded with silver dollar-sized pancakes lovingly cooked by our abuelita, Ruth Magnenat. Then the rest of the family would join us for a delicious meal, usually around dinner time. And my grandparents adopted my mom as if she were their daughter. This had a wonderful impact on my mom. She grew up poor and in the care of the Salvation Army's children home, La Aurora, in Santiago, Chile, and she needed that sense of belonging. Dad was a kind uncle and loving brother. His sister, Lieutenant Colonel Renee Brewer, and husband David were on the mission field during my childhood and spent part of each furlough with the Magnenat family. In essence, Dad got another brother as part of that exchange. Both were men of God, spoke Spanish, and had burgeoning families to consider. Dad's sister became like a sister to Mom and was also a tremendous support to her. There was a lot of love in our house as a result. By now you should get the idea that Dad was a loving husband and faithful dad to each of his kids, Brita, Fred, Philip, and me. To Brita's kids, he was their papa, filling in the role of dad. He encouraged their participation in positive activities and being careful about their selection of friends and activities. He also treated his daughter-in-laws as if they were his kids with loving admiration. Dad visited Fred and Anolia on several occasions to experience life in paradise. They live in Kailua, Hawaii, and Dad was fond of fully participating in the Hawaii lifestyle, even learning from his grandkids, Nikki, Zach, and Jonah, how to throw up the hang loose gang symbols. Dad appreciated the many kindnesses my wife Heidi and Fred's wife Anolia showered on him. He knew it required work to remember his likes and his dislikes. He loved the attention he was showered upon by his daughter-in-laws. He shared his life experiences via video for my grandkids to ensure they understood the value of holding on to the three F's in their life. We spoke about this yesterday. The importance of faith, family, and freedom resonated with him. He loved his Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He loved his family, and he loved the freedom he possessed as a result of his U.S. citizenship. Dad was not immune to the heartbreak of devastating loss. His baby sister, Brita, died at an early age in Chile as a result of a fall. My brother, Philip, died in a car accident in Mexico in 1987, and Mom suffered 12 years as a result of her illness before being promoted to glory upon her death. Despite all this, Dad remained faithful in his allegiance to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. Dad was a loving and faithful husband, as well as a dad you could look to as your North Star when trying to determine the best decisions to make. You should be comforted that Dad cared deeply about each of you. I can personally attest to this fact. We had a lot of phone conversations, and he shared the interest interesting facts that made each of you special to him. He always stressed the positive. He admired those of you that stood in the gap for others. He mentioned you by name. I know and admire these qualities in you as a result. Well done, good and faithful servants. And that's what I wanted to share about my dad.
Such a privilege to be here today. I received an email a few weeks ago from Major Rob Reardon, my office in Los Angeles. He said we're going to have a celebration of life for John Magnenat. And he said to many in that email letter who had been scattered all over the territory since our time together here at Seattle Temple over the years, if you want to send a message, please do. Or if you can make it up, that would be great. And in my heart, I said, I really want to be there because this man of God deserves every honor that I can give and every chance, as Amy said, that we can celebrate this exemplary soldier, this beautiful, humble servant of Christ who dedicated his life to Christ. It's not surprising to me that the song he's chosen for us to sing is How Deep the Father's Love for Us. He chose this for this occasion, as I'm told. It's not surprising because he knew the love of Christ in his life. He knew that deep love, and it filled him. And it was clear from everything I saw in him that everything he did, all the ministry, all the good things he did, just flowed because of the love that Christ gave to him. But I think another reason he may have chose this song is because he wants you to know that there's a deep love for you that the Father has, and he wants you to know today that he's hopeful that you know that love that Jesus gives each one of us. So I'm going to invite you to stand, and we're going to sing this song together. We're going to have a short introduction from the band, and we're going to sing these words that are the good news of your gospel, that we can have hope and life through Jesus Christ. So let's sing together.
Hi, my name is John. I was born in Peru in 1926, and since then, my life has been a constant walk with God. My father and mother were both Salvation Army officers, which was the world I was born into. I moved to Santiago, Chile, when I was very young, and it was there where I had mentors who guided me that softened my heart towards receiving Christ. I also got married in Santiago and then moved to Winnipeg, Canada. My wife and I welcomed our first son there. After 5 years, we moved to Seattle, which was there where I worked for the next 26 years. Our family grew with 3 more children, and I became the band director for the Salvation Army Church there. After I retired from the business world, my pastor asked me to shepherd a weekly Bible study group, which I did for 23 years, while at the same time working with seniors on a weekly basis. Right now, life is amazing, and I'm still having fun, but it hasn't always been that way. I remember the time of having to carry my son's ashes across the border from Mexico after a car accident. I also remember the 12 years of wondering why there was an illness that slowly stole my wife's life away as I took care of her. But the only way through the pain was taking every day step by step and trusting in the goodness of God. We had to sell our house just to pay for my wife's medical bills. I didn't know where I was going to live, and I still had no answers from God as to why a faithful family was suffering like this. After she died, I still had no answers, but I learned that even more importantly, I didn't have enough perspective to make assertions about God's justice. Over those 12 years, I learned that our world is far too complex to try and use my understanding to judge God's character. It is not for me to know all the answers, but I accepted His invitation to trust His wisdom. When I was tasked with overseeing some Bible studies, I found that I did not possess the knowledge to steward that. When given the responsibility, I studied and became knowledgeable. It was the same way with learning His Christian walk. I started without any knowledge of God, but when I accepted the responsibility of learning who God was, I came to know Him as my Father. Now, I feel I have the faith of a small child believing in his Father. The journey continues as I continue to learn how to trust in the Lord and show faithfulness in every situation. I was just remarried, and my wife and I are having the time of our lives. Life has taught me that reliance on the Lord will bring me through disaster to restoration.
Discussing what we could do, who we could share, whose testimony could share and encourage the hundreds of people that would be in attendance. And I shared a little bit of John's story, and all the pastors at once said, yes, let's do that. And that video is the result of that pastor's gathering and that shared worship. So John's message, John's faith, John's testimony went beyond our church, went beyond your family, went beyond North Seattle into the world. There are about 20 or so people watching online right now, and the messages that are coming through on the chat are very encouraging and very uplifting. Your father, your grandfather, your husband impacted many, many lives. And Gunnar, I agree. I think that cornet lick in Call of the Righteous was being played as John walked through those pearly gates. And St. Peter probably said, John, St. John, here is your seat before the Father's throne. And John took up his cornet, or perhaps even the baton, and began leading the heavenly band. I have a few letters to read, and then we're going to open the mic if there's anyone here this afternoon that wants to share how John impacted your life. So I have two letters and half a letter and a video from a former Corps officer here at Seattle Temple. The first letter comes from Major Ronald Lee Fenrich, who with her husband Ron were the Corps officers. Yes, he was a drummer, Amy. Ronald Lee says, I first came to know John as a college student in the late 1980s when he was a bandmaster. Coming to Seattle Temple, I was now involved in a larger and more sophisticated band than I had ever experienced before. I was intimidated, but he was a kind and patient man who led the band with incredible godliness and integrity. When I returned as a Seattle Temple Corps officer 22 years later, John was retired from the position of bandmaster, but sat in the band mentoring the young musicians in the cornet section. This talented, deeply respected man was still so very humble and gentle. He rarely, if ever, referred to his past leadership of the group, even though he had earned the right to. He made an impression on me. Unlike other bandmasters I had worked with before, he was openly far more concerned about the spiritual lives of his band members than he was with their musical ability. I'm so thankful to have sat under his musical and spiritual leadership. Ronald Lee Fenrich, Major. The second letter comes from Colonel Terry Griffin, who played in this band, who is our divisional commander, and he writes my tribute to John Magnenat. John Magnenat is alive. There is no doubt in my mind that John is still walking the halls and is involved in the activities that take place at the Seattle Temple Corps. You may not see him, but his presence can be felt. Sorry. There is much that can and will be said about John. Some refer to him as Saint John. While he would not agree with this promotion to sainthood, he is certainly one of God's special people who gave his all to love and serve people in the name of Jesus. Music played an important role in John's life. In fact, he was recruited by the Seattle Temple Corps to be its bandmaster. John became famous after teaching a future general of the Salvation Army, John Larson, how to play a horn while in Chile. Why is John alive? He is alive in my mind's eye, as I'm sure he is in yours, but for different reasons. I vividly remember John accepting me into the band and placing me in the second chair in the solo cornet section next to a young lady by the name of Linda Bodden. I can see John with his red hair and beard, bigger than life, walking into the old Seattle Temple Corps building to lead band rehearsal. I see him leading the band sensitively during Sunday morning holiness meetings and at the open air service at 5th and Pine, the Sunday salvation meeting. On the march, at special occasions, and leading one of the bands each year at music camp. John was tireless, always prepared, a wonderful teacher and mentor, and stalwart Salvationist. After many years of leading, John turned over his baton to a young upstart from Sweden by the name of Stefan Winston, and John took up his place in the band. I will admit that Stefan learned well. I guess it is what it is. Most of you will know that John's matchmaking worked. Linda and I were married in 1967 and attended the School for Officers training from 1968 to 1970. Four of our first five appointments as Salvation Army officers were in the Northwest Division and close to Seattle. Whenever we had time in Seattle, John and Rafi would make us feel like we were a part of their family and always part of the Seattle Temple Corps family. Whenever we were able to visit the Corps, John and now Stefan will tell us, your horns are ready in the band room and you have a seat in the band. In Genesis chapter 5, we learn of Enoch, and it simply says that Enoch walked with God, and then he was not, for God took him. There is no greater tribute than to say that a person walked with God. John Magnenat walked with God, and his life is written on the tablets of our hearts. Well, John, well done, John. Good and faithful servant. The last email that I have comes from Major Rob Burks, And I'm just going to read the very end of his email, because then he also sent a video that we'll watch. John was larger than life when I was just a teenager at Seattle Temple, and when I grew up and served alongside him, almost 30 years later, his shadow of Christ-likeness loomed even larger. I loved him. Rob Burks, Major. And let's listen to Rob singing a song he wrote just for John.
When I first met you, I was just a kid. Thoughtless in the things I said and did. You seemed old even way back then. A gentle giant in the midst of men. A place where the unseen were not heard. For me, you always had the kindest word. Quiet master of the band. Music would follow the move of your hand. Oh, St. John. Oh, St. John. The divine is God. I left there, I never knew that I'd return to serve with you. So much had changed, but you never did. You were still the man, I was still the kid. Oh, St. John. Everyone agrees you were the best. But at 94, you deserved a rest. Go on to glory and take your place. You'll forever fall into grace. Oh, St. John. Divine is gone. Oh, St. John. Oh, St. John. The divine is gone. The divine lives on.
Share a word, come up now, and you can use this mic. Tia, will you unmute this mic? And the floor is yours.
Well, I'm not shy, and I don't need a mic. All right. You're almost loud enough, anyhow. So I had the privilege of John and I hanging out in the second cornet section many times, talking. We went out to dinner and had some really good chats when I was started doing social services, and we had the Christmas party for the Silver Crest. We'd always have a quartet and sing some songs before we chowed down with the folks from the Silver Crest, and always asked John in October if he'd like to play in the group that was going to play, and he always did. And I gave him a cornet, and after seniors lunch on Tuesdays, I could hear him in the back in the band room practicing this is in October, and we were having a Christmas party. And then when we opened up the food bank, John was right on the spot. He stood for 3 hours. I can hardly stand for 3 hours. He stood for 3 hours, and he was at the first table when the clients came in. They signed in, and they went over to his table, and he shook every one of their hands. Wow.
Anyone else?
My earliest memories of John were from when I was about seven or eight years old, going to band camp. Now, those of you in the Salvation Army know we call it music camp now, but back then, it was all about the band. So, and they had bands, right? So they had A band, which was the best band, all the way down to D band, which was the worst band. And I remember seeing this giant man. He was Bandmaster Magnenat from Seattle Temple. They had the biggest band in the division. So he was this, like, he kind of scared me, to be honest. I was like, ooh, Bandmaster Magnenat. And I'm telling you what, I was the back bench cornet player in the D band. So every music camp, band camp, music camp, I would advance a little bit. I think I got up to B band, but I never got to sit under Bandmaster Magnenat. So I admired him from afar, but I didn't really know him. And it wasn't until a few years back, when I came back to Seattle Temple with my daughter, Annalise, that I really started to know the man. And you would think that a man of his advanced years, with his history of service, would be content to just sit back and let other people attend to him. But no, this man made a point of seeking me and my daughter out to encourage us, to welcome us, to show us kindness. And I don't think I've ever met a man as humble and as kind as he was. Psalm 116 says, "Precious in the eyes of the Lord is the death of his saints." And if any man ever deserved that appellation of saint, I think it was Bandmaster Magnenat.
Anyone else?
Sorry, who's in the back? My name is B. I am in the band, as you can tell. I was one of the last group of kids that joined the band while he was bandmaster. And I've always called him Bandmaster. I'm not going to start calling him John now. And I don't think that it's easy to convey what that means. It has very little to do with music. I don't know if any of you have ever read the orders and regulations for bands in the Salvation Army. But in there, it talks about how a bandmaster is really the spiritual leader of the corps. Corps officers come and go. Some are better than others. But a bandmaster is somebody who's there, somebody who's a rock, and he was here for my whole life. I've been in the band for 41 years now. And I played under lots of better conductors, famous conductors, with better bands, but there's no other bandmaster fighting that. There's no better bandmaster than that. And he showed us, I gave a testimony about him once at a songster concert, and I talked about how he used to take me home after band. And that's just a small thing, but it affected me. And I remember it now. And I'm kind of always trying to take that to heart. It's those little things that he did for 95 years, 94 years, that really affected all of us. It wasn't some grand, you know, speech or grand musical achievement that we're all caring about now. It was those little things. And that's what he taught me.
Anyone else?
Thank you. came to Seattle when I was 21, and I had never been to Seattle, actually, for a very short visit. I was a euphonium player who had the privilege of sitting next to John when I was super young, and I was not a terribly good euphonium player. I'm not really now either, but then I was still sort of figuring out how this whole thing worked, and I sat next to him, and he was never anything but kind to me. I would mess things up, and he would gently remind me that I was supposed to play F sharp or whatever, and always kind. And then I went away for a while, and I went to college and you know, learned band better. And then I came back and sat next to him again on euphonium here in the band. And again, he was always just kind and gracious to me. And then at some time along the way, he decided it was time for us to switch spots. And said, Gina, I'm gonna move down a chair and you're gonna come sit in this spot. And I thought, there's no way I'm ready for that. But John was confident in me. And then many years later, when I lost my husband, he prayed for me, and he loved me, and continued to seek me out on Sundays, and make sure that I was okay, and make sure that I knew that I was loved, and I will always treasure that about him.
My name is Ken Lyons, and I had the privilege of also playing in the band. I started out on the second cornet bench under Bandmaster Magnenat's leadership when I sat next to Ronnie Bodden, actually, at the time. Having my whole life. In fact, John was, you know, practically neighbors, just down really on 101st. We were on 100th Street. We were kind of neighborhood kids that started coming to the core when we were younger. There is something about John, I think, that has kind of stuck with me and really has echoed really in the last couple of years, even before he was promoted to glory. And that was this, we were at a core council meeting, that's like the church leadership group. We were talking probably about visioning for the next, fulfilling the Salvation Army's mission to, save souls and grow saints and serve suffering humanity. And, you know, we're talking about all of these different ideas and things like that. And then John said something that really has stuck with me and really has, really echoed over and over again. He said, let's get on with it. Let's get on with it. Not so much just talking about it, but let's get on with it. Is life not too short to be worried about, being obsessed with pride or greed and acting of it? Let's get on with it. Let's get on with the business of building the kingdom. And that is something that has stuck with me. And I could go on and on about how John has encouraged me over my entire life. That's something that continues to echo in my own life. Let's get on.
No more questions about theology. He doesn't wonder what the extent of human free will is anymore. No more questions about things in the Bible. This morning I was reading in Exodus. I was reading the plagues that happened upon the Egyptians, and I noticed something that I hadn't noticed before. One of the plagues killed off all the livestock. It was, I think, the fourth plague or something. And then when the hailstorm came, it killed off livestock. And I was thinking, well, where did the livestock come from? They were just killed off. How did they get more livestock? John doesn't wonder that. And you've probably read things in the Bible, too, and you've said, wait, I don't quite get that. He gets it. No more questions about the cosmos. Like, what exactly is a black hole? Some of you might know. I should know. What is a black hole? Is there life on other planets? Is time travel possible? John doesn't wonder these things anymore. No more questions. No more questions.
No more earthly concerns. John no longer worries that he might fall. He doesn't worry about becoming ill. Not crossing his mind one bit. He's not concerned about what we're doing down here. Now, I know that we often take comfort and we say to one another, oh, he's watching us right now. I don't think that's scriptural. In fact, I think maybe we think too much of ourselves when we think about him watching us. Because really, if we think he doesn't have better things to do right now than watching what we're doing, then we don't have much to look forward to. We are not the main act. C.S. Lewis described it so well in his book, The Great Divorce, when he talked about how this is just a pre-life, how we now are the shadows. He talked about when he went into the next life in his imagination, this is C.S. Lewis, and he went into the next life and he was still sort of in earthly form. He was in a middle situation and he could barely put his feet on the grass because the grass was so sharp, because it was real, and he as a human was a shadow. This is the pre-life. That's the real life. So John isn't sitting around looking down, wondering what we're doing down here. He's past that. And he knows nothing more of peril or arguments or strife or politics, racism, disagreements. He doesn't know anything about that. No more earthly concerns. No more dim view. The scripture said that we see things imperfectly, like puzzling reflections in a mirror. Or the King James, Amy, said, a dim reflection that we see now. A dim reflection. But John doesn't see a dim reflection anymore. He has a completely clear view. He understands God. Think about your greatest question about God. Surely you have one. Surely there's something about God that you just don't get and you wish you did. I know one of the first things I want to find out when I get there. I'm going to say, how does this Trinity thing work? How are you three and yet one? How, I don't know, I don't fully get that. I can't wrap this mind around that. But he gets that. He gets that. He sees that clearly. Oh, don't feel bad for John. Most importantly, he sees and worships the Lord, the triune God in all his glory. He sees and worships the triune God in all his glory. Seraphims and cherubims around singing, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. And I suppose that John may still be flat on his face in worship, singing, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. And John sees that now. Oh, someday I will see that too. Someday most of you will see that. And if you don't know if you're going to see that someday, if you don't know if you're going to be there, talk to somebody here. And maybe that doesn't sound great to you. Maybe that sounds boring to you. Let me promise you, it's going to be so much more amazing than anything that we as human beings have ever known. There is so much to look forward to. You will never again say, I'm bored. You will never again say, how many calories in that pizza? It's celebration. It's joy. It's consummation of everything we've been waiting for. for. It's every question answered. It's the peak of peaks of peaks. And John is there. If he could look down, I think he'd have one thing to say. Be sure that when your time comes, you join me. John poured himself out while he was on this earth. He held nothing back. From early life till he was 94, he gave 100% as father, as husband, as bandmaster, as salvationist, as lover of the souls of humanity. John held nothing back. Nothing was left undone. Don't you want to feel that way when you realize it's the day you're meeting the Lord? Won't it be wonderful if you can say, I've left nothing undone. I did everything that God wanted me to do, and now I rest. That's the story of John. May it be the story of Amy. May it be the story of you. Thank you, Father. This place, this time, this man we honor. Thank you for giving him to us for 94 beautiful years, for every life he touched. We give the glory to you because that's what he would have us do, and because you, oh God, are the deserving one. No human is deserving of eternal glory, only you. We're just grateful that someday we will be able to see it ourselves. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Hello. Good afternoon. It's great to be here. Great to see the family. Everybody's grown up, and you introduced them all over again. So experience that. I won't introduce my kids yet. So I appreciate, there's a little bit of irony in asking a bandsman to lead a song at the end of any service, but I have been asked to lead this song, but I can't let the moment pass before saying a few words about my friend. So John Magnenat, as he was for many, was one of the standard bearers of faith for me. My siblings and I, you saw my brother Ken, I grew up in this neighborhood a few blocks from the Magnenat family. It was at the Magnenat house that I had my first few lessons on the cornet. As a young teen, John invited me and my brother into the Seattle Temple Band. This included bringing by a pair of new black shoes so that I could fully participate in uniform, as well as playing carols in front of a kettle during Christmas in Northgate Mall, just the three of us. So in the early days, he was Mr. Magnenat to me. For many others, he was Bandmaster. I probably only began calling him John, and with some trepidation, when my wife came to work here at the Corps and worked side by side with him in retirement. As our family grew, he took delight in our kids, sharing a laugh, some encouragement, or a gift. That's my son James, and he has a hat that he got from John. You want to wave that? There it is right there. His Jimmy. But to label him Bandmaster only, while appropriately honorific, is to limit the dimension of the man. He was our friend, he was our mentor, he was our encourager, he was our husband, he was our papa, he was our grandfather, he was our dad. So John was a man of passion, humility, and commitment. He experienced and faced, as you've heard, terrible heartache. He wore his heart for God and for others on his sleeve. He also had a full-throated laugh and a great sense of humor. The contradiction of being a bandmaster is the control required of a conductor, while inside, the heart sings with abandon, and that was John. Once the baton was set down for good, the voice was no longer constrained, and the the songs of faith, hope, and love from, and you would sit somewhere over there, were sung with a hearty, sometimes rough, accented, but tuneful voice. The songs that we would hear in full-throated joy were amazing love and blessed assurance and boundless salvation. And so this was John's lesson to me and my fellow musicians and salvationists, teaching us to join the unending song of praise to our Creator, sung in unison with imperfect voices, harps, and sometimes with horns. A song passed down from and joined by generations of salvationists, our Methodist forebears, and indeed the Church Universal. So I'm going to lead a song. When you've heard it, there's going to be no cornet introduction to this one, Gunnar. But when the roll is called up yonder, and so this is your opportunity to sing with the band. This is your opportunity. This is the Salvation Army to clap during the chorus. This is a chance for you to renew your commitment, as the final verse says, to labor for the kingdom, or to make a new commitment to labor for the kingdom. So please stand with me, and there will be an introduction from the band. Please clap.
Gave him up for us all, how will he not also along with him graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who is he that condemns? Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who is raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. And we pray this.